Good morning. Once again, welcome to the Athens International Winter School 2018. We continue with our seminar, and there is a change in the program because life is flowing and we have to flow also. Yesterday we had a subject that had to do with anger and emotions in general and how they affect the life of a person. I thought it a good idea to continue today with thoughts, because thoughts come before emotions. And in the same way that in yesterday's lecture we have seen how emotions are produced and what are emotions and their role in illness, in the same way I thought it would be very important to examine today thoughts, thinking, and how different kinds of thoughts affect us, either affect us and produce illness. Yesterday we have, and all the times that we are having case analysis, we refer to emotions and evaluate these emotions in order to prescribe, in order to reach to a diagnosis of the miasmatic and constitutional picture of the patient. In the same way, when we note down the phrases, the actual phrases of the patient, we have to be able to interpret these phrases and decide if these phrases are normal or natural, and we are not interested in these as doctors. We are interested in the pathology, physical and psychological, and decide if they are abnormal. Because an abnormal thought, an unnatural thought, creates unnatural, imbalanced emotions, and these emotions create unbalanced primary and secondary behavior. So, if we can learn what is an unnatural thought and what kinds of unnatural thoughts are psoric, psychotic, or syphilitic, and what kind of unnatural thoughts correspond to each and every chronic constitutional picture, then we can be able to interpret and translate what the patient thinks and feels and how he behaves into the prescribing of the signillium. So, let's begin discussing in order to achieve holistic thinking. Because in our school, the School of the Homeopathic Academy, we teach the classical miasmatic constitutional homeopathy that is characterized by holistic thinking. And holistic thinking is the higher manner of thinking of man. It corresponds to the conscientious soul, to that level, to that higher level. While usually, when we think according to the intellectual soul and sensational soul, we have the mechanical thinking, the most widespread kind of thinking nowadays in the syphilitic era that we live in. Our main effort in education in the classic, in the homeopathic academy is not, our aim is not to give you knowledge, to put in your mind kilos and kilos and tons of knowledge. A computer can do that much more perfectly than human. A computer can store up numerous information, but we are not a computer. We are a human multi-level being. So, what we should give you as trainee homeopathic doctors is to not give you, but help you create, help you start functioning in a different way, in an advanced way, the holistic way, the holistic thinking. In this way, you are going to be transformed. Not all of you, all those who want and are able to do so, and are eager to do so, to be transformed in a person that thinks holistically, feels holistically, and behaves holistically, according to the natural laws, according to the universal and homeopathic laws. We are not giving you a new ideology, a new ideological system, a new philosophy. No, we can't and we don't want to do that. We are just sowing the seed in order to, we are just watering the seeds that you have inside you, being human beings. You have the conscience inside you. We are not focusing on the intellectual, so on the mind. We give information, but we don't just give information. What's most important, and it doesn't depend mainly on us, the trainers, it depends on you, is to develop, we water the plant of the consciential soul. And then you can be true homeopathic doctors. If we focus on the intellectual soul, on the mind, on the ego, then you are going to think in a mechanical way that you already do. You already do mechanical thinking. And you may be very good allopathic doctors, but you are not going to be very good homeopathic doctors. There are so many homeopathic doctors that keep thinking, even after many years of homeopathic practice, keep thinking in a mechanical way and practice mechanical methods of diagnosis, repertorizing, keynote prescribing, computer expert systems. You can find that in other schools. In our school, we are trying to think holistically, and that's why we practice the classical miasmatic constitutional homeopathy. Because in homeopathy, you are the tools in order to diagnose. You have a person in front of you, a multi-level human being. You don't have a machine. You don't have a brain in front of you. You've got the brain and the heart and the spirit and so on. So, if you are just thinking by the brain, you will recognize only symptoms, isolated symptoms, rubrics. If you are functioning not only with your body, senses, mind, but also with your conscience, you can observe much more. You can invade, observe, call it as you like, the mind and the soul of the patient. Only then you can diagnose his passions, his abnormality in all levels. Not only his physical pathology, but also his psychological pathology. And because it's all in the mind, both health and illness, if you can read the mind of a person, you can diagnose his miasmatic and constitutional picture. It's not difficult. It's the easiest way if you transform yourself. It's the hardest way if you remain a person who thinks mechanically. So, let's start talking, discussing. What is thought? Yesterday I asked you, what is an emotion? Today I ask you, what is thought? A thought, what is it? The simplest questions are the most difficult to answer. And it's what philosophy does and true science does. We start thinking without, as if we know nothing. If you start asking yourself and nature as if you know nothing, then you are objective. If you say, I know what's a thought, according to my philosophy, according to my ideology, according to scientific experimentation, thought is this. You can go to a dictionary and be satisfied, but you can't find wisdom in dictionaries or in the repertories. You can find knowledge, you can't find wisdom. What is a thought? Come on. You are now thinking at this very minute, and I am thinking, and I express to you, I communicate to you thoughts. And if you speak, you are going to communicate to me a certain thought. And we don't know what the thought is. What is a thought? Let me try to think holistically. Let's start from easier things. Is a thought a mineral, part of our human body? Is the thought brain, a part of the brain, a material part of the brain? Is the thought a part of the material world? Can you weigh thoughts? Can you touch them? Can you measure them? Can you have a CT scan and photograph, capture a thought? No. Does that mean that it doesn't exist? If we think in materialistic thinking and mechanical thinking that only body exists in man, then we have to say that a thought is some kind of a chemical substance of the brain. But it isn't. Maybe an electrical thing of the brain. lower energy, but it isn't. In the past, science thought that only the material world exists, and only the material world was the reality. All other things were fantasy, were demons. They didn't exist. In fact, at those days, scientists said that it only exists in your mind, in your fantasy. But is there something that doesn't exist? It's a foolish thing to say. Even from the moment I think of something, it exists. And it's not created by me. It was already existing, even if I didn't know about it. So, is there anybody here that supports that a thought is something material? No. Okay, then. Is thought something that has to do with etheric energy? Part of the etheric world? We can't touch energy, lower energies at least. But even lower energies, we can detect them by energy equipment, light, ultrasounds, and so on. But if we go to the mother energy, to the energy that creates all other lower energies, electricity, magnetism, and so on, we go to the etheric energy. Is thought part of the etheric world? No. A thought is part of the psychological world. What consists our psychology, our thoughts, and our feelings? So, thoughts, in the same way that chemical substances and minerals are part of the material world, in the same way, thoughts are the materials, in brackets, the materials of the psychological world. Our thoughts are not closed into the skull, inside the brain. We can communicate these thoughts by speech. There are so many cases when a mother who loves her child very much can sense, can start thinking at a certain point, without any stimuli, that her child is not well and is thinking something awful at that time. And she takes up the mobile phone and rings up to her daughter, and amazing, she was right. In the same way that lower energies are not limited to time and space so much, the material world, is very much or completely limited by time and space. But the lower energies are not so limited in space, they can cross the universe almost instantly. When we come to the etheric energy and to the soul, to the psychological world, we have even less limitations as to time and space. And we go up to the world of uniqueness, the world of uniqueness. There is no time and space over there, as we know it. While this is the word of diversity or duality, from this limit downwards. So, thoughts. It's the material, the material. It's the content of the psychological world. In the same way that our material body is the child of the material world, and during our earthly life we constantly exchange materials with the material world, in the same way our etheric body is the child of the etheric world and constantly exchanges etheric energy with the etheric world. According to the universal law of analogy, we have the same thing in the psychological level. Our individual soul exchanges thoughts all the time, constantly, with the psychological world. Yesterday we said, and I repeat it, that although this is against our human egoism, we are not primary producers of thoughts. We borrow them from the psychological world, either from the lower or from the higher. We have the gift of limited free will. We have the telecontrol of the limited free will in our hands, and we push the buttons each time in order to choose canals, information to see a movie or the news of the lower psychological world or the higher. When my husband cheats on me, I have the telecontrol in my hand and I choose either to be jealous and revengeful or to say, I forgive him. A relation needs two people. Okay, let's get over it. I choose from the lower psychological world, affected under the influence of my miasmatic and constitutional influences, and from the ideological systems and mental patterns of man, of the human society. Or I choose with the telecontrol to be tuned with the higher psychological world, and we will see what kind of thoughts do we have there, to what they differ from usual thoughts. And then we have the spiritual world. What kind of thoughts do we have there? Do we have thoughts? No. We have ideas, as Plato has defined them, ideas. Nowadays, ideas and thoughts, we consider that it's the same thing. We think that ideas are thoughts. They are not thoughts, as Plato has defined them. They are prototypes, spiritual prototypes, the original documents, the prototypes that have both the material, in brackets, and the know-how of how the psychological, all the contents of the material world all the contents of the etheric world and all the contents of the material world are created. Because from the spiritual world are created the rest of the worlds of universe. So, do you think that I speak metaphysically? Well, modern science and astronomy says that the world was created in an instant time, in an instant, in a very tiny space, from energy. And from the energy world, after the Big Bang, started the creation of the material world. So, science, modern science, has started touching what the ancient philosophers have said and what many religions have said about the creation of the world. But modern science limits this knowledge into originally on the material world, and then they have discovered that there exists a lower energy world. And these two are together, are combined. There will be a time that they will start discovering that there are other worlds also, other levels of existence. Because if we think that the body of man is only the material body, and the world is only the material world, we think that this is the only reality. But there is much more reality that also exists, even if we don't know it. Don't forget that 100 or 200 years ago, science accepted only the existence of the matter, of the material world. And now it changed. Other sciences like physics, chemistry, and mathematics have advanced. The chemical therapeutic system that nowadays prevails in medicine has not advanced. It says that only matter is what makes a man. Only the material body exists. Only the material world exists. And so tries to find the causes of all diseases in material causes, in the material world, and the means for cure only at the material world, with chemical material medicine. But acupuncture, homeopathy, and other energy therapeutical systems have advanced and are using etheric means, energy, superior energy, etheric energy means, therapeutical means, remedies. So, since it's all in the mind as to pathology, we have to focus more on the mind. As we have many times said, soul has three levels. The intellectual soul, that is ego or mind, who is the manager not only of the system of individual soul, but also of the whole system of the human being. It's the mind that has the telecontrol in hands. The other two parts are the sensational soul that connects the soul to the etheric body and the material body, and through them to the material and etheric world. There is another part, the higher part, the conscientious soul, or conscience, moral conscience, call it as you like, that connects the soul, the individual soul, to the individual spirit, the drop of God that we have inside us. And through the individual spirit to the individual world and to God or universe, or call it as you like. It doesn't matter. We are talking about the Creator. We are talking about the Supreme Being. Call it as you like. It's the same. If you believe in religion, if you are an atheist, if you believe in science, and you call God universe, it's the same thing because it has the same properties. We identify in science a material or an energy by its properties. We don't see ultrasounds, but we say that they exist because they have certain properties. In the same way, the Supreme Being has certain properties. It has created the world. It has always existed and will always exist. It is full of wisdom and love, and so on. It is the one that has made the universal laws according to which the universe is being ruled. So, religious people and atheist scientists say the same thing. They give the same properties, but the one calls the Supreme Being God, the other calls it universe. Nothing changes. Only our fanaticism. Nothing else. So, let's go to the point of mind. It's all in the mind. Why? Because it's the manager. How does it act? How does a mind act in order to think, to have a mere one thought, or many thoughts? Where are thoughts? In the psychological world. How do we get the thoughts? By the law of similarity. If I am a person that I have limited free will, if I choose to be tuned to the lower psychological world, then I am much more influenced by my admirers and by constitutions and by ideologies created by human minds and by the society. This is the source that we, this is the supermarket from which we shop. We buy thoughts, either inferior thoughts or superior thoughts. If my intellectual soul, my mind, is tuned to my conscience, to my conscientious soul, if it is inspired by it, then we buy, we get, we receive thoughts, higher thoughts from the higher psychological world. I told you the previous example. I have an incident happening to me. What is an incident? I have stimuli from the material world and the etheric world. My sensational soul gets the material stimuli go to the brain, and from the brain they are taken from the sensational soul. Sensorial soul. So, sensational is something else. A little bit. Sensory soul. Sensorial soul. And the sensorial soul gives this material to the intellectual soul, which is a manager. And what happens there? my thought, if my the stimuli is neutral, I don't have the creation of a desire or of an emotion. If it is not neutral, if it is a personal opinion, either positive or negative, then I desire and then I believe. And beliefs create emotions, emotions primary behavior and secondary behaviors. So, my desire is affected by the stimuli that I receive, but most of the times, not more, the stimuli are always neutral. I see a woman. It's a woman. It's an information. It's data. It is not something positive or negative. I am the one, my mind is the one that makes this information neutral, positive, or negative. If I have been, I'm a man and I have been cheated repeatedly by women, I say it's not a woman, it's a bitch. If I am a person that has lived a very good relation with a certain very good woman, and I am a man, I tend to see a nice woman in front of me, and I have the creation of positive feelings. So, what I desire, what I want, is very much and mainly influenced by my constitutions and ideologies. And what I desire with the telecontrol, I become. Because according to the law of similarity, which is a universal law, I attract what I am and what I want. Hippocrates said, we are what we eat. Kent, one of the great masters of homeopathy, said that we are what we think and what we will. That's what makes a man. What he permits his mind to think, to choose to think, and what he permits his limited free will, to want. Because according to what you think and desire, it's what you choose to believe. You go to the supermarket of ideologies of the society and you choose what fits your thoughts and desires, your desires. If I want, I told you that, I will tell you an example. If I am a dominant person, and if I have too much ego, and if I want to serve this ego, then I want to be dominant. And I'm influenced by the syphilitic mayas and syphilitic constitutions. And then I want to have dominance. And this tendency is sugar-peeled by an ideology. I have my real intention to be dominant, and in order to be accepted by society, I choose a certain ideology that says that those who know and those who can must have the upper hand. And I choose a certain ideology. If I am Hitler, I say only the Aryan race is the one that must rule the world because it is higher than other races. If I am a cultured person like Plato, a philosopher like Plato. I say that the, what did Plato did, do? He created the philosophy of a society ruled by philosophers, where people should join a certain kind of team. The philosophers that rule, the soldiers that protect the society, and so on. So, this is the manager, and this is how it is done. But there is another factor. I am influenced by my constitution's ideologies, by stimuli, by my ego, by my limited free will, and I have desires, and then comes the conscience, the voice of conscience. Some hear it, some don't. But it always exists in every single man. And says, what do you desire? Is it natural? Is it moral? Is it okay with the universe? Do you feel all right with your conscience? And it may stop or enhance this desire. Socrates said that there is a good demon inside me, the conscience. And it doesn't tell me what to do. It tells me what not to do. It makes me feel lousy when I desire to do something that is negative for me or for other people. And then we have the beliefs, emotions, behavior. That's how man works. That's how your patients work. That's how you work. If you don't know it, you will never know if a thought or an emotion or a behavior is natural or unnatural, positive or not, higher or lower. What is the criterion that a thought is unnatural or an emotion or a behavior is unnatural? Christ, Jesus Christ said it, and so many philosophers. You will judge a fig tree by its fruit, by the results. If a thought makes me ill, either to the body or to the mind, then it's unnatural. And if it's unnatural, it is a characteristic of a certain Mayas or of a certain miasmatic picture, or of a certain constitutional picture. You cannot tell me that your thoughts are higher and good if you beat your wife, if you feel hatred, if you have thoughts of hurting other people. You can say anything, you're a hypocrite. What is a secondary behavior? What is an inconsistency? We say, the patient says something, and he means something else, quite different, and he does something different. He hasn't got unity.